If you're a founder who is serious about iterating to meet user needs, these are my recommendations for app analytics tools. Google Analytics for ad campaigns and user acquisition tracking. One core product analytic tools like Amplitude or Mixpanel to track user journeys and conduct A/B testing. Add a sessions or heat map tool like UXChem for qualitative data. Links are in the description. You can stop this video right here if you want. I'm going to provide a more thorough explanation of why and how you should use these tools and why I don't. If you'd like to hear that, stick around. In app development, iteration based on user need is an endless cycle. But how do we know what users need? Sometimes they leave productive comments. Take this for example. If this was my app, it hurts to hear, but I know what to fix. Sometimes all they'll say is this. My feelings are still hurt, but I don't know how to help. And for every dissatisfied user that comments, 10 more just close your app and never open it again. The next time they notice your app, they go, huh, when did I download that? Delete! To truly understand these users, mobile app analytics tools are the way to go. In this video, I'll ultimately share two use cases in app development that do best with different sets of app analytic tools. It's nothing to do with cost and everything to do with what you're trying to achieve. The first use case is app focused, dealing with bugs and keeping the app up to date and running as efficiently as possible. It's more to technical aspects and catered to app developers like myself. The second use case is user journey focused, making sure that users are getting what they need from the app. That's what gets you their loyalty. It's far more holistic, and if you're a founder, this one is for you. First, we need to look at some key metrics. As a developer, I'm interested in metrics that measure the technical aspects of the app. If I was a marketer, I would be interested in metrics that track acquisition and conversion. If I was a founder, I would be interested in all of them. We'll start with something that everyone should be paying attention to, user flow. This lets us see the path users take when they open the app and start navigating between events. An event is a term for actions that people take on your app. Tap a button, download the file, send a message, and many more. Some events are what we call goals, actions that can define why you built the app in the first place. Classic example, if you were running a marketplace, you'd want your checkout page to be a goal. If you were running a fitness tracker app, you'd want start tracking and end tracking to be a goal. Between the first and goal events are other events, aka a funnel, and every event in that funnel is a chance for something to go wrong. The user flow indicates whether the funnel is working. 10 users going into the funnel should end up as 10 goal conversions. If they are dropping off midway, a developer needs to ensure it's not app related, and a marketer needs to make changes to make it more compelling. If they've both done their job and still no conversion, we try different features and track any changes. To my knowledge, the user flow is the one metric that's universally important to everyone in app development. Doesn't matter your role, the user flow will inform you how to do your job better. App performance metrics. The next metrics are specific to app performance and would be something a developer looks at. Crashes and ANR, application not responding errors. Crashing is not just a good way to get a one-star rating and an angry review, but the app stores themselves can detect apps with high crash rates and will warn developers to get their shit together. If you don't fix your app and it still crashes, they get taken down from the app store altogether. And not all crashes are created equal. There are crashes and then there are user perceived crashes, which users actually notice, and app stores are particularly finicky about them. App startup time. There are three different types of starts. First, you have a cold start, where your app is being launched for the first time. Next, a warm start, where your app is relaunched after very recently being closed. And lastly, we have hot starts, where your app is running in the background and the system brings it to the foreground. It depends on the complexity of your app, but as per Google's guideline, cold start shouldn't take longer than 5 seconds, warm starts no longer than 2 seconds, and 1.5 seconds for hot starts. Page rendering time. This measures how long it takes to load images and text on a screen. If you've ever had a page appear with blank squares and janky alignment that slowly corrects themselves as the page loads, you've experienced poor rendering. It's not possible to deliver a good user experience if pages take 10 seconds to load or worse, never load correctly. Usercentric Metrics. These metrics are for anyone responsible for growing the app's user base and leading marketing campaigns. Disclaimer, I'm not a marketer and don't pretend to be, but I can bullshit my way through this. Isn't that what all marketers do? There are more specific metrics when it comes to tracking users, and I'm just going to list the big ones here. User demographics, retention, conversion, cost per acquisition, customer lifetime value, session length, traffic source. Each of those metrics is a piece of an overall puzzle. Piece the puzzle together and you'll find out details about your users' behavior, preferences, and needs. You take that information and decide what iterations to make to the app to better serve your users, keeping in mind you should still be profitable. Then you and your developers discuss what changes can actually be made, and we, the developers, start the iteration process while paying attention to our app performance metrics. This goes on forever, or until you go bankrupt, whichever comes first. Matching app analytics tools to desired outcomes. Anyone with a role in app development benefits from using app analytics tools, no question. But depending on whether your focus is on improving the app or improving the user journey, you benefit from using different tools. If your priority is to make sure the app works, your metrics should be focused on the app, and anything beyond that is a potential distraction. If your job is to improve the user journey, then you don't want to hyper-focus on app performance because you need to consider many other things and how they come together. Simple example, customer lifetime value. Strictly as a developer, as long as it's not caused by bugs or wonky UI, I don't care how much my clients are making per customer. Actually, I should care how much my clients are making, just so I know they won't forget to pay us. If I was a product manager and did know this, I would be fired. First use case, for app and site-centric analytics. This is my use case. My responsibility is to deliver an app that works well, and this means killing bugs, a seamless user flow, and low startup and rendering time. For this, I found that the basics are more than good enough. Google Analytics 4 for user event flow across both platforms and web. Firebase Crashlytics to track crashes, errors, and bugs. Google products can easily be used and to track both Android and iOS apps as separate items. Also, remember that sometimes you have web apps that use a separate operating system. It's just three simple steps. Head over to the official guide and follow the instructions. Between those two tools, any developer will have access to the metrics that matter to them. Hey guys! To me, non-tech founders are still founders and need to play their part. We're gonna look at the app analytics use case for founders next, but before that, I'd really appreciate it if you guys would subscribe to this channel and like this video. Thank you, and back to the video. Second use case, for user journey and product analytics. My duty is to understand who my users are, where they are, and what they need. That means user demographics, marketing strategies, new user acquisitions and churn rates, customer lifetime value, total revenue. As a new founder, you're going to be running lean. Someone has to look at product analytics, and it's preferably you, because only you can really decide on the direction of the app. It's your app. You look at the analytics, you speak to your developers, and decide what iterations need to be done. Also, it's good to learn while your app is still new, so you sort of grow with your app. By the time it turns into a full-blown unicorn and you are swimming in pools of cash, you have a solid understanding of app analytics. So as far as tools go, what you're really looking for is a product analytic tool. My recommendation, keep Google Analytics for ad campaigns and user acquisition tracking. Add one core product analytics tool like Amplitude or Mixpanel to track user journeys and conduct A/B testing. Add a sessions or heat map tools like UX Chem. I'll start by explaining why keep Google Analytics. Google Analytics lets you see what happens before users reach your app. It shows you the links your app has with various sources of user acquisition. Where are they coming from? What ads or keywords did they see and search for before ending up on your download page? So if you want to launch and measure marketing campaigns, affiliate links, or viral videos, Google Analytics will help you do that. There's nothing else quite like it, and it's mostly free. Why add a separate product analytics tool? The product analytics tool will be your main weapon. Mixpanel, Amplitude, Heap, any and all of them. They let you track user journeys, group your users into separate personas based on behavior, and set up A/B testing directly on the platform. Here's a list of the top 5 mobile app product analytics tool and their specific USP. See which one sounds the most appealing to you and go with that. Amplitude, free tracking of up to 10 million events per month. Mixed panel, in our opinion, the most user-friendly interface. Heap, most comprehensive automated data collection. Full story, most comprehensive playback of sessions. Warning, most expensive on this list. Post hoc, access to testing and heat maps even on free plans. If I had to choose one for most people just starting out, I would go with Mixpanel. The user-friendly interface and ease to use makes all the difference. While they have slight differences and unique selling points, it's not going to matter to you yet. Your main concern is to pick one and get used to it. It may be painful. It will be a pain in the ass. Your future self will thank you for that. This is one of the rare cases where I will say that pricing is a valid consideration. Some charges based on number of users, others charge based on number of events. The thing is, pretty much all of them offer free trials based on usage limits, not time. So you have nothing to lose here. If you have a friend who does marketing for a living, ask them to join your first time using the tool so they can guide you. Why add a heat map tool? Heat maps are recordings that show where users click, scroll, and spend the most time on your app screens. You can see what successfully grabs user attention and what doesn't. Also, with session recordings, you can see where user might struggle to locate a certain button or complete an action. This gives us powerful qualitative data to validate whatever is being indicated by the quantitative data from our Amplitude and Mixpanel, which sadly do not offer heat mapping and session recording on their platforms. Say for example, a lot of your users are not completing a certain action. You want to know what's going on, right? Well, record a session with your heat map tool and you'll be able to see how users are navigating the screens. There may be others, but I believe the main option right now is UX Cam. And yep, it also offers a free trial. They always offer free trials. With these tools, you're pretty much set to measure every aspect of your user journey and improve upon it. The biggest challenge is the initial learning curve. Once you're over that, it's going to be a lot easier. Thing is, if you are serious about app analytics, you can't ignore the two main app stores. Just like how websites need to be tweaked to rank on Google, you need to be thoughtful and methodical about your app store page if you want it to be visible. It's called App Store Optimization. And here's a video I made covering everything you need to know. If you found this video useful, please subscribe and let's dive into App Store Optimization.